Today we're talking about design patterns. While most junior engineers focus on getting their code to work, experienced engineers take it a step further. They think about efficiency, scalability, and long-term maintainability. But here's the thing. This isn't a typical video on Singleton, Factory, and Observer pattern. We're going deeper. Today we'll break down 5 advanced design patterns that can make your code cleaner, faster, and easier to maintain. These patterns are used in industries like gaming, e-commerce, banking, and media, but they're often ignored in most tutorials. Stick around, because the last pattern is so powerful that banks and stock markets use it to track millions of transactions per second. So going into the first pattern, let me ask you something. Have you ever wondered how video games render thousands of objects, like trees, without crashing your computer? At first glance, you might think the game creates a separate object for each tree. But how efficient is that? Let's do some quick math. Each tree has a type, a color, and a texture. So if each tree takes 50 kilobytes, then a million trees would need somewhere around 50 gigabytes of RAM. And that's just for trees. We haven't even added characters, buildings, or anything else. Clearly, this approach doesn't scale. So instead of storing 1 million separate trees, we store just a few unique types like pine, oak, or maple, and we reuse them across the entire game. But how do we do this? First, we extract the shared data into a tree type class. Now, instead of each tree having its own data, we store only one instance per tree type. To manage these types efficiently, we use a factory method. Before creating a new tree type, the factory checks if it already exists. If it does, we reuse it. If not, we create and store a new one. This factory method ensures we don't create duplicate objects. Finally, when creating a tree, we only store unique positions and we reuse the shared data. So instead of creating 1 million trees separately, we only store a handful of tree types and a million lightweight position objects. And just like that, we've completed the flyweight pattern. This pattern helps us save memory and boost performance when we have tons of similar objects by sharing common data instead of duplicating it. Flyweight is widely used in game development, UI rendering, and text processing. Now let's move to a common e-commerce problem. We're building an e-commerce website and we want to show users only the products they're eligible to buy. Sounds simple, right? Just check their age. If they are over 18, they can buy alcohol. If they are not, hide it. But what if some products can only be shipped to certain countries? Or maybe some items require a premium membership. And for legal reasons, some products can be bought by users who haven't verified their identity. As you can see, it keeps getting worse, as business rules never stay the same. Now our simple product filter is full of endless if-else conditions. And making any updates is like playing Jenga. Remove the wrong piece and everything falls apart. But instead of hard-coding rules all over the place, how about we turn rules into reusable objects? Here's how we can do it. First, we define our base specification interface. This interface is generic, meaning it can take any class as parameter. Next, we create an abstract method to validate a specific rule. But we also want to combine rules dynamically, so we create 3 more methods, and, or, and not. Now we create separate specification objects, one for each rule. If we want to check if a user is both an adult and from US, we can combine rules dynamically, like this. If we also need to ensure the user is not from a restricted state, we combine these rules with a not method. And if premium users have full access, we can simply add an or condition. Notice how we didn't modify any existing code, we just created new rules. This is the specification pattern. It is widely used in e-commerce filtering, authorization systems, and business logic, where rules constantly evolve. So we've optimized memory with flyweight and cleaned up our conditions with the specification pattern. But what if we need a way to undo mistakes and restore previous states? That's where our next pattern comes in. Imagine we are working on a text editor. We delete a paragraph, but now we want it back. How do we restore it? Every time we make a change, the system saves a snapshot of the document's previous state. And when we hit undo, it rolls back the last snapshot. That's exactly what the Memento pattern does. In this pattern, we break down the problem into 3 parts: the originator, the memento, and the caretaker. First, let's define the originator. This is the object whose state we want to save and restore. In our case, it's the text editor. The most important part is the save method, which creates a snapshot of the current state. Next, the memento stores a snapshot of the originator's state. The key point here is that the memento holds the state without giving us access to it. This keeps the encapsulation intact. And since it's final, the state cannot be modified after it's saved. Finally, the caretaker is responsible for storing the memento and retrieving it when needed. Every time we save the editor state, we push a new memento into the stack. When we hit undo, we pop the last state and restore it. This pattern is widely used in text editors, photo editors, and video games. It's lightweight and ensures the integrity of our object state. Moving on, let's build a video player. At any moment, it can be playing, paused, or stopped. And when the state changes, the behavior should change too. We could write a bunch of if-else or switch statements. But what happens when we need to add new features and new rules? It gets hard to read, maintain, and scale. So instead, we encapsulate each state into its own object. Here's how the state pattern works. First, we define a player state interface. This interface defines the three main actions: play, pause, and stop. Then we create separate classes for each state. Each state only knows how to handle its own behavior. If the player is playing and we pause it, it transitions to the paused state. If we play it again, it transitions back to the playing state. Now let's connect this to the video player class. The key idea is that the video player doesn't need to check its state. It simply delegates the action to the current state. Each state object handles its own logic, making the code clean, scalable, and easy to maintain. This is the state pattern. It's perfect for media players, UI components, and game state management, where objects change behavior based on their state. So now that we've created our media player, it's time for the last pattern. But before we move on, if you enjoyed this video, hit the like button. It helps me know that you find this video helpful, and I can make more content like this in the future. So for our fifth pattern, we are building a banking app. For this, we need to keep track of every withdrawal, deposit, and transfer, basically every event, so we can rebuild the user's entire balance history at any point in the future. And the big question is, how do we store this information? So we can break the problem like this. Our current balance is our current state. So if we have $100 in our bank account, our initial state is $100. Then we have three possible actions, each representing an event. If we transfer $50 and withdraw $10, we have two events. And each event captures a state change, and together they represent the full history of the account. This is the event sourcing pattern. A key part is that in event sourcing, we never overwrite data. Each transaction is stored as an immutable event, and the balance isn't stored directly in the database. It's derived by replaying all past events. Let's simplify it with a clear structure. First, we need to build our events. For this, we create an abstract class with an amount and an apply method. Then we create specific classes for each event, extending our abstract class and implementing the abstract apply method. Next, let's define the bank account class. It has a balance, a list of events, and methods to process an event and to get the balance. And instead of storing the balance in the database, we store a log of events. So if we deposit $500, we withdraw $200, we don't store the balance as $300. We store two events, a deposit and a withdrawal, and we calculate the balance by replaying the events. Even if the system crashes, we can rebuild the balance from scratch and we never lose data. This pattern is especially useful in situations where we need to audit a transaction or to detect frauds. Event sourcing is widely used in banking apps, financial systems, and order processing systems where history tracking is crucial. But while those patterns create a clear structure for our code, how do we ensure it's flexible and maintainable? That's where principles come in. So watch this video next to see how solid principles work and how they can improve your code to easily manage and extend it.